Good afternoon. Welcome to the DeSSA Alternate Assessment State Guidelines Participation Criteria Overview. My name is Jessica Bass. I'm an instructional coach at the Access Project at the University of Delaware. I also have with me Michelle Jackson, who works with the Office of Assessment at the Department of Education. And Medra.
Hi, everyone. Medra Surratt with Parent Information Center of Delaware, and we are facilitating this webinar today. I'm the Executive Director of Parent Information Center. PIC is a statewide nonprofit organization that seeks to improve the educational outcomes of all children, with a specific focus on children with disabilities and special needs by providing their families the information, education, and support needed to advocate on behalf of their children. So thank you all for having for joining us today. In addition to Michelle and Jessica, we also have joining us Megan Conway, who is the project manager of the Access Project. And before we get started in the presentation, just want to let you know that the webinar is being recorded, therefore all lines will be muted. If time permits, we will address questions at the end of the presentation, and you may use the chat feature on your screen to submit your questions. This webinar is an overview of Delaware's alternate assessment. If there are specific area or specific questions that you have regarding the alternate assessment or the process, you will be provided with the presenter's contact information to reach out to them directly. And always remember that PIC is a resource for you as well. Lastly, you will receive a survey link immediately following the webinar. Please take a few moments to complete the survey, as your feedback is essential in providing continuous services to families. And so with that, we'll move into our presentation. Michelle?
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Michelle Jackson, as stated before, and I'm the Education Associate for Special Populations. So in addition to being the lead for the DeSSA Alternate Assessment, I also I also oversee the accommodations and accessibility supports for all of the DeSSA assessments, and I also manage the 1% cap along with Access Project. Okay, so we're going to get started on our webinar.
So in this webinar, we are going to cover the following topics: the definition of a student with significant cognitive disabilities, and Delaware's participation guidelines, and finally, how to keep parents well-informed. So who is a student with a significant cognitive disability? How do you define a student with a significant cognitive disability? What does this learner look like? What are the common learner characteristics for a student with the most significant cognitive disability? Sometimes knowing who the learner is not will help us determine who the learner is. The term most significant cognitive disability is not a separate category of a disability. It is a designation given to a small number of students with disabilities for the purposes of their participation in the statewide student alternate assessment program, who are within one or more of an existing category of a disability under the IDEA law, and whose cognitive impairments may prevent them from attaining grade level achievement standards, even with systematic instruction. The Every Student Succeeds Act, ESSA, provided states with explicit instructions when defining a student with significant disabilities. The next two slides show the provisions for what the state definition should include and exclude. So I think, go back. So the first thing the definition must include, it must address cognitive functioning and adaptive behavior. It must identify curriculum, Curriculum refers to the methods and materials used to teach the content and skill defined in the standards and the order in which they are taught. And then it's also to identify exclusionary factors. When Delaware crafted their definition, the Department of Education used input stakeholder groups such as the AGEC, which stands for the Access to the General Education Curriculum Agencies, also agencies such as the Center for Disability Studies, and also across work groups such as the Office of Assessment and Exceptional Children's Resources, in order to craft and revise our definition. An official Delaware definition was crafted in the fall of 2019 and has been included on our participation guidelines and our companion guide. The definition states, a student with a most significant cognitive disability is one whose disabilities pervasively impact his or her intellectual functioning and adaptive behavior. Significant deficits in intellectual functioning result in the student requiring extensive direct instruction and substantial supports in order to make measurable educational gains. Significant deficits in adaptive behavior often result in the student being unable to develop the skills needed to live independently or to function safely in their daily life at home, in school, and in the community. And then as a result, the student is learning academic content that is reduced in depth, breadth, and complexity. You will notice the word pervasively in this definition, which basically means that the student's is impacted across all areas of their life. And most of all, with the assessment in mind, it means that the student is impacted across all academic areas.
Mm-hmm. So that word pervasive means that it goes across their educational, social, independent life. You're going to see the impact of that disability across every single aspect of the student life. And so that word pervasive is really important, and it drives the definition and it drives all our actions in the participation guidelines.
So what does this mean? The general education standards and state assessment is not appropriate, even with accommodations, for a student to attain grade level achievement. So the student must access the learning content using the Delaware Alternate Achievement Standards, which means that they are instructed using the Dynamic Learning Map's essential elements. The student's performance will be measured by participation in the DeSSA Alternate Assessment.
And so parents, it's very important that you know from the get-go that your students are being instructed on the essential elements. And as we stated before, these are less complex in depth, breadth, and in complexity as well. So basically, the goals are the instruction that the teachers are working on should address the essential elements. That's a key part of your student participating in the DeSSA Alternate Assessment.
So what does a profile of this learner look like? So for a student with the most significant cognitive disability, his or her learning characteristics include factors related to cognitive functioning and adaptive behavior. Data will confirm that the students with the most significant cognitive disabilities are in the disability areas of intellectual disability, autism, and multiple disability. Additional characteristics of students with a significant cognitive disability who are likely to participate in the alternate assessment include students with diverse receptive and expressive communication skills. So parents, when you meet with the IEP teams, when you're making a decision of whether your child should be on the alternate assessment, please consider the data sources that you review for evidence of a significant cognitive disability. And these assessments will include psychological assessments, so that ESR that the school psychologist goes over, and then assessments of adaptive skills, classroom observations, formal and informal assessment data as outlined in the participation guidelines.
And then also the IEP team should also document why the general curriculum and assessments are inappropriate, even with accommodations. And so they also have to talk about how the student will be assessed and why the alternate assessments are appropriate.
So some of the actions necessary for someone to live independently and to function safely in his or her daily life involve conceptual, social, and practical skills for which the student lacks proficiency.
Let's now get into Delaware's participation guidelines. So our state participation guidelines were revised to include Delaware's state definition, and Jessica highlighted, read this through for you earlier, and this is located at the very beginning of the guidelines. The participation guidelines are found in Appendix B3 of Delaware's Accessibility Guidelines Manual, and that's located on our webpage, and it's also on your slide on the screen. You can see it's www.doe.k12.de.us. And that /ALT. So a student with the most significant cognitive disability should be found eligible to participate in all of the content areas. So this is a shift. This is a change. Previously, you had an option of participating in ELA or math. Now, because of that definition, which has been expanded to include that word pervasive, this means that the student has to be found eligible for both for ELA math and science. So if they're not being considered for all three content area, then that suggests that the disability or multiple disabilities is not pervasive. And so the student, your child, would then participate in the DeSSA or SAT general education assessments with or without accommodations. And so, yes, there is a checkbox that the team must indicate that this eligibility is being considered, as you can see on your screen, okay? So let's now look at our first criteria. Having a significant, or we're gonna say most significant cognitive disability is not determined by an IQ score. The IP team must make this determination based on a complete understanding of the student. So basically that question that you wanna look at is, does this student have a disability or disabilities that significantly impact that cognitive function and adaptive behavior? So you want to review the student records and other evidence that's presented at the IEP team meeting. All those, after that review, it must indicate that the student has a disability or multiple disabilities that prevent your child from being able to meaningfully participate in the standard core curriculum and to achieve general content standards, achieve progress in the general content standards. And so the student disability causes a dependence on others for many and sometimes all of their daily living needs. And then the student is expected that they're going to continue to require extensive and ongoing support even into adulthood. So if you look on your screen on that criteria one, you can see where we further broke that down by saying a student whose disability or disability affect all areas of his or her academic, social, and communication and daily living needs. And so the student is dependent on others, and that is not expected to change. So we want to further clarify that for you so you understand exactly what that criteria is saying. Looking then at criteria number two, on, you can see on your screen where the student requires specialized direct instruction and or a wide range of supports to acquire and transfer skills to school, homework, and community environments. So this is not temporary or transient. This is something that, as I mentioned before, is ongoing and is expected to continue through adulthood. So this student is using a lot of adaptive materials. They get a lot of their information that's presented different than what you're used to seeing for other students. And so the support from the classroom teacher and even others in the classroom, you are seeing a lot of one-on-one instruction. You're seeing a lot of assistance being given, a lot of repetition being done in the instruction, and that's what it looks like for this learner, okay? And so when we see here that they have to be able to transfer skills, we want this, typically a learner will be able to transfer skills, what they're learning across different classes at home or in the job, but this student is demonstrating that they're not able to do it at the same speed or level or complexity or depth as other learners, all right? And I'll let Jessica talk a little bit on the next slide.
So adaptations are changes made to a learning environment and curriculum, instruction, and or assessment practices. So accommodations and modifications help support the student when they are interacting with the general curriculum and with assessments. So these supports are individualized for the student and they vary based on the student's need. So you may have, on an assessment, you may have students that need simplified instruction. On the alternate assessment, you may need the visuals modified, and also how many problems are in each testlet, maybe reduced in depth and breadth. So, these adaptations are important, and you definitely see them in the IEP and something that we present to teachers and EDs is that they have to make sure that most of these accommodations can also be used on the assessment so that students have consistency when it comes to supports.
Thank you so much. And the key word on your screen that you see underlined is that it is individualized for your student, for your child, okay? Looking now at criteria three, you can see where basically, as was pointed out earlier, this student is being instructed on the DLM essential elements. And that's the vendor that we use, the dynamic learning maps, those essential elements, and they are known as the Delaware Alternate Achievement Standards. And so they need that instruction modified, extensively modified. You saw how it was pointed out earlier what the adaptations that are given and how they're individualized. And so it's the same thing that applies right here to the instruction. So it's less complex and depth of skills. So if it's less complex and depth of skills that the students are being instructed in, the assessment has to match what they're being taught. Okay. And so these essential elements are then taught at whatever grade level your student is enrolled in, your child is enrolled in, rather. So in addition to other data sources, you see here there's an acronym, the LCI was completed. This stands for the Learner Characteristics Inventory. And this Learner Characteristics Inventory was developed by the National Alternate Assessment Center in order to investigate the true learning characteristics of students participating in alternate assessments based on alternate achievement standards, or what we call the DLM essential elements. And so this LCI tool is not used as a sole decision-making tool, but it should be used in a, as an additional data source. And what we want you as parents and guardians to know is that you should be included in this discussion. And this LCI should be completed yearly and hopefully prior to the IEPT meeting. And so when it's shared and discussed, you then get a chance to share on your child, because you know, as parents and guardians, you know your child better than anyone. And so you should be a part of that discussion as well. Okay. And so that's criteria four. Now, if I didn't mention it before, if we did not point it out before, we're definitely pointing out now that all criteria has to be met. Every single one has to be met in order for the student to participate in the alternate assessment. So if the student did not meet criteria one, we would stop right there. We'd not keep going with that consideration. If they do not meet criteria four, if the LCI is not discussed and shared, and you get a clear picture of what the learner should look like that participates in this assessment, then we should stop right there. The meeting should not continue, or the consideration should not continue. So in addition to the LCI, you also have to review other sources of data. And the LCI data can, as I pointed out before, is going to share teachers' perceptions of the student characteristics, but also yours as well. You are needed to participate in that. And the document would most likely change over time as your student grow and as your child make gains. We want to see that document shift over time, as well as pointing out any unusual patterns that may occur to help our teachers drive the instruction. And the snapshot on your screen right here is just a glimpse of what, a quick snapshot of the first page of what the learner characteristics inventory should look like.
Okay. So some other data sources in addition to the LCI are state assessments. So that's gonna be your DeSSA alternate assessment, which this spring, because of the national shutdown due to COVID-19, students did not actually take the alternate assessment. That may change. We are waiting for guidance for that. Also, standardized measures, so your ESR with your psychological assessments, as well as any assessments that measure skills. So your adaptive skills, also anything like MAP testing. You may have a student that takes the MAP test. And then skills observed in the curriculum-based and teacher-made materials. So this evidence should be coming to the IEP meeting and produced by the general education teacher as well as the special education teacher, showing you students' progress in regards to their IEP goals. And these pieces of evidence may actually vary. It may be formative assessments, so exit tickets, or worksheets that students complete in class to see if they meet a daily goal, but also summative assessment. So when your child is taking unit tests or any tests to kind of sum up what they learned for the semester or trimester.
Okay, thank you so much. And so this leads us now to our final criteria, criteria five. And criteria five is basically, these are what should not be used as a criteria for participation decisions. And you see that there are nine things there. So the student inability to participate in the general assessment, even with accommodations, is primarily the result of a most significant cognitive disability and not any of these. The existence of an IEP, a specific category level label. So we can't say that because the student has this particular category of disability, this automatically qualifies them to participate in the alternate assessment. No, we need the IEP team, and you're a part of that team. We need careful consideration and discussion and deliberation to place the student on the alternate assessment. So it's not based on poor performance on the general assessment, any visual or auditory disabilities, poor attendance or extended long absences, administrator decision, anticipated disruptive behavior, the impact of test scores and how it's going to impact the school's accountability. It shouldn't be based on academic and other services that the student receives. For instance, it shouldn't be, my child receives speech, so they should be on this, or my child receives occupational therapy or physical therapy. So it shouldn't be based on any of these other services. It shouldn't be based on the student's educational environment or instructional setting. And it shouldn't be on how it's a percent of time that your child is receiving special education services. So because the student has let's say 80% of special education services, does not mean that, hey, this student should be placed on the alternate assessment. If your child needs accommodation, it doesn't mean that they should be placed on the alternate assessment. And any emotional concerns or distress, these are not the sole reason why a student should be placed on the alternate assessment. So that's what that criteria five means. We want the IEP team to carefully consider, especially the first three or four criteria, excluding these reasons in the deliberation or the discussion. So the final snapshot, there's more to the participation criteria, but basically with each of the criteria and the IEP team discussing the and deliberating the learner, they're going to check off a certain score. And so based on that, if they have reviewed all and rated all five criteria, the next step involves tallying all the points from the rating scale. So that has been added to the participation guidelines. So if your child receives an 8 or a 14, they would not meet the eligibility criteria. Basically, your child must score the maximum of 15 in order to participate in the DeSSA alternate assessment. Why are we doing this? Because we want to make sure that we are seriously considering the assessment for your child. And we want to make sure that we are engaging them in a meaningful assessment for them. We want to be really considerate of the learner. So if that student has a score of 15, then the IEP team would check, yes, the student meets the criteria to participate in the DeSSA alternate assessment. So as a parent or guardian, it's important that you're aware of the consequences of your child participating in the DeSSA alternate assessment. There are some consequences that you have to be aware of, especially when it comes to graduation and college requirements, which is why the ESSA, the Every Student Succeeds Act, was also written with parents in mind. They made provisions for you as parents and guardians. You play a huge role in determining your child's eligibility for participation in the DeSSA alternate assessment. And it's important that you understand, as we've pointed out before, that your child is being measured on alternate achievement standards, which are less complex and the depth of skills are less than those for the general assessment than the regular content standards. So there are consequences for your child participating in the DeSSA alternate assessment, which may affect your child achieving a regular high school diploma. And so if you look on your screen, you see that it is that you are clearly informed as part of the process. So what did Delaware do to meet this law? This is what we did on the participation guidelines. You are going to see this section, and this is the final section before the signature page of the participation guidelines. It has a parent and guardian assurance, and these assurances should not be pre-checked before the meeting. You, as the parent and guardian, must check yes to all the assurances before you provide your initials, all right? And we are urging you to answer yes or no to these honestly. So the first thing that you're going to see is that it says, I understand that my child's participation in the DeSSA alternate assessment may lead to a diploma of alternate achievement standards, which may not be accepted by colleges and technical or trade schools. So you have to check yes to that. Then you have to check yes to, I understand that the standards assessed in the DeSSA alternate assessment are less complex than the Delaware content standards assessed in the DeSSA general assessment. We've added this piece, which is that you participated in the learner characteristics discussion. And that means that LCI piece, they shared that information with you and you understood everything of what it pointed out, you check that yes box. And then the last sentence talks about information about that you received information about the DeSSA alternate. That is a fact sheet about the DeSSA alt that is located on our alternate assessment webpage. And again, that webpage is on your screen that you can access this document, but you should also be provided with the option to receive that information as well. It is also available in Espanol, in Spanish, for our parents and guardians that need that as well. And another note, this DeSSA alternate participation guidelines will be available in Spanish and in Haitian Creole. So it should be presented to you you'll have it presented in that particular language if you need it as well. We want to make sure you understand everything that's occurring at the IEP team meeting. The state has also released a one-pager that outlined the comparison between the Delaware High School Diploma versus the Diploma of Alternate Achievement Standards. So you can ask your IP team leader for a copy, or you can access this document as well on our website, and you'll find it on our website under the Educator and Parent Resources tab. All right, so this was developed and it gives a side-by-side look on the high school diploma versus the diploma of the alternate achievement standards. So once that parent section or parent and guardian section is complete, your signature is next. So this is the signature page for all IEP team members. And this is the final assurance that after careful deliberation and meaningful discussion, and this must occur yearly. I cannot repeat that enough. It is a yearly decision. The IEP team then agrees that the student has met all the criteria and that the team agrees with the decision for the student to participate in the alternate assessment. Please remember, parents and guardians, that you are a part of the IP team and your decision has impact. We'll take a moment if we have any questions at this time.
So, Michelle, I don't see any questions in the chat box, but thank you so much to you and Jessica for sharing this information. I wanted to also, if I could, briefly share the, if you could share the Delaware DOE's alternate assessment page. I think it's just helpful. I added the link in the chat, but I also think it's helpful for parents to be able to see what that looks like once they get to that page.
Absolutely. I can do that right now. Hold on.
And I did have, while you're doing that, I did have a couple questions. So you talked about the, you mentioned that it has to be a pervasive impact, and that the student has to, part of the eligibility criteria is that the student has to meet those areas in ELA, math, and science. And so I know, and you also mentioned that when you talked about criteria 5, there are oftentimes, and we've seen this within our organization, our parents have contacted us, where there have been students who were behind several grade levels in a particular subject area, and they were being considered for the alternate assessment. Can you talk, talk briefly again about that process and what this looks like for families? Because we know that many families might introduce that discussion or bring this concern to the IEP team, and they think that their child may benefit or may qualify for the alternate assessment. And I just think it's important to revisit the eligibility criteria and the parent's role in that process.
Okay, so to rephrase, it sounds as if you're saying that if a student is below grade, several grade levels in academic performance, then does that qualify the student to participate in the alternate assessment? Is that the question?
Correct. So I know it doesn't, but we've had those questions, we've had that concern. And so you mentioned the criteria and kind of walking through the process. And so for families, just to understand that the student has to meet all of that criteria, and it doesn't necessarily mean just because your student is behind certain grade level at a specific grade level, that doesn't necessarily mean that they qualify. They need to go through this, the team needs to walk through this process to determine that eligibility.
And that is absolutely correct. The reason why we're constantly revising our guidelines is because we do want to prevent these assumptions that based on the student performing below grade level, this is an automatic qualification for the alternate assessment. That's the reason why, as well, the 1% CAP team, after further research and discussion and presentation with stakeholders, further expanded the definition to include that word pervasive. Because sometimes when we have our learners that are performing below grade levels, you may see that impact only in one subject area. So you want to ask yourself first, as the IP team should be considering, is this across all content areas? So a student that has a significant reading difficulty and is showing in ELA may be zooming through math. This does not indicate a pervasive or what we call as a most significant cognitive disability that is pervasive. So one of the things that we have done as a state is develop for our educators of how to work with the students that should be participating in the general assessment with accommodations is by creating an inclusive practices course that educators can then say, what can I do for this learner? Am I using all the resources? There are a lot of accessibility supports available for our learners in order for them to access the general education curriculum. It's important to know that the students on the alternate assessment would be that learner that if you gave them all of these accommodations and supports are still unable to access the general education curriculum in any subject area. And it then falls into their communication and into their adaptive behavior, all of these other areas as well. So the social, the communication, and the academic. So it's a complete learner. And that's why we have included the learner characteristics inventory as a part of the discussion, not as a decision-making tool, but as a part of that discussion. So again, parents and guardians, is not enough that the student just meet one area. They have to really, it's about the whole learner and meeting all of the areas on the criteria on the participation guidelines. So all of the criteria have to be met. And you also have to consider what is most meaningful for your child. You know, yes, they may be below grade level in this particular content area, but then they're acing through in math or even on science. And so we want the student on the assessment that's going to most cater for their needs, and it's most meaningful for them. And so that's our aim. It is still based on the learner. It's still an IEP team decision, and everyone, including you, have to be in agreement with what is presented there. So I'm going to take a moment and show you. I'm at www.doe.k12.de.us. And if you just type in Delaware Department of Education, you should see this pop up on your screen. And then there's a message here related to COVID. So you're going to click continue here to our site. Once you're on our website, instruction and assessment. We're talking about the Delaware alternate assessment. So you're going to go to this tab. When you click on that particular tab, you're going to see assessment. When you hover over the assessment, you're going to see alternate assessment. When you click on that tab, it will bring you to the Delaware alternate assessment webpage. And on this page, you're going to see the grades that they're tested. This is a link to the accommodation form for the DeSSA alternate assessment, and other information is here. Our definition is here as well that you can see. And then you keep scrolling down till you see family and educator resources. This is where you're going to see the DeSSA alternate assessment fact sheet. We also have the fact sheet presented in Spanish. And you're going to see that high school diploma versus the diploma of alternate achievement standards. And I'll just click on this link quickly just to show you. And I'll just increase it so you can see it a little clearer. So it tells you what it means for a high school diploma versus a diploma of alternate achievement standards. And it shows you, and it outlines all the graduation requirements. And this, it tells you the accommodations that are allowed. It tells you the modifications allowed. And it tells you, is this accepted by the military? Is this accepted by colleges? Is a student eligible for federal student financial aid? And is this accepted by employers? So all of this is here for your information to read through. And this was posted as of February 3rd. So this is available. The links used on the website, as well as information to dynamic learning maps. The website is posted there, and the blueprint for the assessment and other information is here as well. So this is how you would access this page. What I suggest is, once you found this page, then you can just hit it and hit the bookmark so that then you'll be able to access this page a little bit quicker. I hope that helped a little bit to show our parents how to access the web page.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to let everyone know, we will be rebroadcasting this on November the 12th. So there's another opportunity to listen in. And if you have any additional questions, also we'll be sharing, we're going to post the link to the alternate assessments on DOE's website. We're going to post that on our website, and also share this to our social media pages, just so you can access the link from there as well. Because I think especially that fact sheet is going to be really helpful for families to kind of see the difference between the two. And also just wanted to mention that this is the first of a series of webinars that we'll be hosting. We also will be hosting a follow-up webinar in early December. And the Zoom link information will be available shortly for that, where we'll take a deeper dive into the alternate assessment and supporting families. And I also just want to note that PIC staff also have bilingual staff as well. Our organization has bilingual staff. And so we will be working collaboratively with Michelle and with the Access Project to develop parent materials and in multiple languages. So this information is available to you as families, so you can be prepared as much as possible for to have these discussions in your child's IEP meetings and can meaningfully contribute. So again, Michelle and Jessica and Megan want to thank you for sharing this wonderful information to get today. This was a great introduction to the alternate assessment for families, and I think that they will find this extremely helpful. I just want to remind our guests that in the chat, there's also the link to the Delaware alternate assessment on the Delaware Department of Education's page. And there's also the link to SurveyMonkey. So once you, at the conclusion of this webinar, if you can take a few moments to complete a brief survey, just with your feedback on the information, if it was useful, if there's additional information that you think might be helpful for future webinars, that would be helpful. Michelle, Jessica, Megan, thank you all again for this information. And did you have any final thoughts? You're muted, Michelle.
I think as a final thought, I just want to commend our parents and legal guardians for taking the time to watch this video. And I urge you to keep going to the Parent Information Center of Delaware's website. And we will be, as Mija mentioned, we'll be posting even more information for you. The more that you know, the more informed that you are, is the better that you'll be able to make the right decision for your child. So I commend you for listening, and please share with a parent and share with other guardians as well, so that they're also well informed. Thank you.
Thanks, Michelle. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
You're welcome. Take care.
Thanks, Nidra.
You're welcome.